One of my friend is also here in this class.
Okay. Sir Narendra, sir.
Hello.
Sir, you can start, sir.
Okay. Pranesh, okay. Good. You already kept on recording. Just 1 minute, I'll just start. Okay, once again, a very warm good afternoon to all the participants and all the guests, and especially to our speaker for the session, Dr. Ashutosh Acharya, Assistant Professor, Sports Authority of India, Lakshmibai National College of Physical Education, Thiruvananthapuram, Kerala. Dear participants, I, Dr. Naren Gangwar, on behalf of Ministry of Youth Affairs and Sports, Government of India, Khelo India, and Lakshmibai National College of Physical Education, Thiruvananthapuram, Sports Authority of India, and on behalf of Principal Dr. G. Kishore Sir, Regional Director, SAI LNCP Region, and the entire team of this program, from my core of heart, I would like to welcome a very eminent, very experienced, and young and energetic speaker, Dr. Ashutosh Acharya sir. Sir, we would like to welcome you.
Sir, thank you so much. Thank you.
As we know, as we can see that you are continuing three sessions, and still you are very, energetic. And dear participants, let me take this opportunity to introduce Dr. Ashutosh Acharya sir. Yes, before I start, I would like to mention he's my senior, he's my colleague, and he's my guide as well. So let me introduce. Sir has a master degree in physical education, sports psychology. Sir has done his PhD in the area of sports psychology. He has the doctorate from Lakshmibai National College of Physical Education, Gwalior, one of the very prestigious institution for physical education and sports. He is an alumni of one of the most eminent college in India for physical education, that is Lakshmibai National College of Physical Education under the Sports Authority of India, Thiruvananthapuram. And he was the gold medalist for bachelor and master during his course of studies. He is a recipient of junior research fellowship and senior research fellowship awarded by University Grant Commission for Higher Studies. Let me mention in between, sir was the topper in bachelor's and master in University of Kerala. The big achievement for sir is having, and now sir has published more than 20 research articles in journal at international and national repute. He is a lifetime member of Sports Psychology Association of India. He has successfully attended many conferences, many workshops, and refresher courses and orientation courses. And also he has delivered many lectures in invited workshop and seminar as well. He had various academic visit to Hong Kong, Taiwan, and for your information, ladies and gentlemen, sir has been awarded with Atushi Fujita Scholarship for his research contribution as a young researcher in the sixth ASPAS Sports Psychology Conference held at Taipei, Taiwan. So it's a big honor, big, you know, proud for us that sir is having with us, and I'm sure he's going to make this session a really wonderful one, a really great, and really, you know, to the level of our participant. So without taking much more time, I would like to invite Dr. Ashutosh Arya sir to please share his vast knowledge and practical application experience with us, with the participant. Sir, over to you.
Thank you so much, my dear colleague, Dr. Narendra Gangwar. I'm really grateful to the Sports Authority of India, Khelo India, and Lakshya National College of Physical Education for giving me this opportunity. And I'm really indeed thankful to my colleague, rather my friend, Dr. Narendra Gangwar, for his kind words. Now, let us start the session. So with the permission of Dr. Narendra, can we start the session?
Yeah, sure, sir. So now session is yours. Please go ahead. Thank you.
Okay, to the participants, very, very good afternoon to all of you, all the esteemed physical education teachers from the different corner of from the different parts of the country, and all the eminent coaches, all the eminent community coaches from the different parts of the country. A very good afternoon to all of you. So today's discussion is about ensuring continuity in sports. So let us, this is basically something about, you know, the sports psychology. It's a more of, you know, psychological aspect session. So we'll be discussing about various aspects of sports psychology in this session. So today in the modern era, mental skills training has become a part of athletic success at strength, power and endurance training. This is thanks to the mindfulness movement or the sports psychology movement and the popularity of meditation, yoga and visualization practice in mainstream media. Research on the benefit of mindfulness, meditation on resilience and stress management have carried over to the field of sports psychology, and many athletes continue to benefit from adding mental skills training to their fitness training routine. Now what happens when we talk about this ensuring continuity in sports, basically we are interested in two things. First thing is, you know, most of the physical education teachers will agree with me, the dropout or the early burnout has become a real problem for the budding sports talent in India, right? So here we will focus on various aspects or various aspects of sports psychology which can contribute or which can help us in preventing the early burnout and at the same time promoting the lifelong physical activity. So in this session we will be discussing various vital points, and the first point being the motivational process. Okay, so the motivation is the most important thing, is a very important thing in sports psychology. If we talk about the sports psychology, if an individual is not motivated to do something, you cannot force him to do. So first we need to know what is motivation. Motivation is, you know, we will not go for, you know, bookish definition of motivation, but I will rather try to explain it. The motivation means this is the main force within you which guides your behavior towards a target, right? Let me repeat, the motivation is a force within you which guides your effort or which directs your effort towards a common goal, right? So now let us understand motivation process. By understanding this motivational process, your concept and your idea about the motivation should be clear, okay? So the first thing, that is unsatisfied need, right? If I just ask you, you will not know movement will be possible. You will not move here and there until and unless you need something or there is a need, right? When you need food, you feel hungry. When you need water, you feel thirsty, right? Aapko jab khane ki zarurat hota hai, when you need food, you feel hungry, right? So the unsatisfied need, that is, for an example, it's food. When you are hungry, you need food, right? So when you need food, that deficiency of food or the deficiency of energy in your body will create tension in your body, right? That tension is hunger. When you are searching for food, when you require food to eat, you feel hungry. And when you feel hungry, you have many options. You need to cook, you need to go to a restaurant or a hotel, you need to go purchase some biscuits. So you have got so many options, but your target, you do anything. But your target has to get a food, to get some food to eat from any of the sources possible. So that is unsatisfied need is food. Like when you are hungry, you want to eat some food. And when you want to eat some food, that creates a lot of physiological changes in your body by which you feel hungry, right? Or aap jab bhuka mehsoos karte hain, when you are hungry, आप क्या होता है कि आपको डिफरेंट बिहेवियर होता है, सर्च बिहेवियर्स. आप क्या करते हैं, खाना ढूंढने लगते हैं, राइट? आप दुकान में जाते हैं, आप फ्रिज खोल के खाना बनाते हैं, आप किचन में जाके खाना बनाते हैं. तो एनी ऑफ द सोर्स, कोई भी सोर्स आप चूज करके, व्हेन यू आर एबल टू अचीव द फूड दैट यू नीडेड, योर जो नीड था सबसे पहले, द फर्स्ट स्टेप वॉज नीड. व्हेन यू ईट after searching for food, when you got it, you have it, you ate the food, then what happens? Your need is satisfied. So the need or this motivational process continues from unsatisfied need till the satisfied need. Once your need is satisfied, then there should not be any motivation. But which is not true so far as we human beings are concerned, because in human life we have many more motivations or many more intentions. Like one intention or one need is achieved, another need arises. Another need is achieved, the third need arises. Fourth one achieved, fifth one arises. So it is something like that, right? But the motivational process is, the first begins from the unsatisfied need or lack of something. When you have lack of something, you go about that, creates a tension in your body, and which gives rise to different kind of search behaviors, and you go about searching for it, and this search process will continue until and unless your need is satisfied or you get what you need. Once you have got the need, that motivational process ends, right? So this is what is your motivational process. Now we have understood motivation. हम लोगों ने motivation क्या है हमें पता चल गया. Motivation क्या होता है? It is something which drives our effort or which directs our effort towards a goal. Right? Now motivational process starts from unsatisfied need and ends in satisfied. ठीक है? अभी if you see in this slide, you know in this slide the motivation has been divided into three different kinds. यहाँ पे देखिए, यहाँ पे अगर आप डिफरेंट किताबें, इफ यू रेफर डिफरेंट बुक्स, तो उस बुक्स में आपको मिलेगा कि एक्सट्रिंसिक मोटिवेशन आर बेसिकली टू टाइप्स. वन थिंग इज एक्सट्रिंसिक मोटिवेशन, सेकंड वन इज इंट्रिंसिक मोटिवेशन. नाउ आई हैव मेंशन द थर्ड टाइप ऑफ मोटिवेशन हियर व्हिच इज कॉल्ड एज एमोटिवेशन, राइट? सो फर्स्ट वी विल गो फ्रॉम सिंपल टू कॉम्प्लेक्स. First, that I am going to explain to you is extrinsic motivation. Then I'll explain you what is intrinsic motivation. Then I'll go on to emotivation. So extrinsic motivation means, as the name suggests, extrinsic motivation is something like when the reason why you are doing physical activity or reason why you are behaving in a particular way is lying outside your body, right? Why you are doing a physical activity, the reason is lying outside your body. Why you are behaving in a particular way, the reason is lying outside your body. So when some external force is controlling the behavior, when an external force is controlling your behavior and attracting you towards it, that kind of behavior or motivation is called as extrinsic motivation. For an example, if you are, suppose you are interested to achieve a gold medal, आपको आप इसीलिए physical activity और workout करते हैं क्योंकि आपको कोई भी competition में आपको gold medal लाना है या आपको silver medal लाना है. So medal लाना is an external thing. This the reason why you are doing a particular activity. आप क्यों मेहनत करते हैं, आप क्यों वर्कआउट करते हैं, आप क्यों फिजिकल एक्टिविटी करते हैं, इसका आंसर आपके अंदर नहीं है. The reason is lying somewhere outside of your body. That means the reason is you want to gain some medal, you want to gain a certificate, you want to get some prize money. So because of that only you are doing physical activity, and this kind of motivation or this kind of behavior will be termed as your extrinsic motivation. That means you are externally motivated to do what you are doing, right? So the behavior will be present for external reasons or because it is important of a value, right? So extrinsic motivation is clear. Now we'll move on to intrinsic motivation. So intrinsic motivation is just opposite to extrinsic motivation. Extrinsic motivation mein kya tha? Extrinsic motivation mein the reason behind why you are doing a physical activity was lying outside your body, right? राइट, ये कोई एक्सटर्नल फोर्स था. बट दिस इंट्रिंसिक मोटिवेशन में क्या होता है, इंट्रिंसिक मोटिवेशन में आप कोई फिजिकल एक्टिविटी क्यों करते हैं, आप कोई स्पोर्ट्स पार्टिसिपेशन स्पोर्ट्स में वर्कआउट क्यों करते हैं, और आप सुबह मॉर्निंग के लिए क्यों जाते हैं, द रीजंस आर लाइंग विद इन यू. यू आर डूइंग इट फॉर योर ओन हैप्पीनेस, फॉर योर ओन सेटिस्फेक्शन, योर ओन एंजॉयमेंट. So the behavior is this, under this intrinsic motivation, the behavior is for internal reasons such as interest, pleasure, enjoyment and satisfaction. That means, so you know, early morning when I get up, I'm staying here in a village in Odisha. So yahan pe main jab subah uthta hu, so main dekhta hu ki bahut sare log aged individuals, you know, most of them are aged individuals, they are, you know, coming for morning work, hundreds of people, you know, early morning when I get up, I see them. But, you know, they are coming every day without any fail. But if you ask them, what is the motivation you are coming every day without a fail, because you are not going to get any medals, you are not going to get any certificates, nobody is going to give you any kind of, you know, financial benefit. So, aap ye activity kyun karte hain, aap subah workout ke liye kyun aate hain? The reason, the answer what you are going to, going to get is, I am doing it for my own pleasure. I am doing it for my own satisfaction. So these kind of activities or behaviors will be coming under intrinsic motivation. Now you have understood extrinsic motivation. You have understood intrinsic motivation. Now let us find out, ye emotivation kya hota hai? Emotivation is something, you know, like when an individual has no particular motivation to participate in such kind of activities. If I ask an individual, अरे आप थोड़ा physical workout करो, थोड़ा थोड़ा आपको आपका सेहत अच्छा रहेगा. No, I don't have any time. See, when he is giving such excuses that he has no motivation or he has no interest to do any kind of physical activity or he has no interest to indulge in himself in any kind of activities, then what happens that time? It is called as emotivation. Those kind of behaviors is called as emotivation. In emotivation, there is no reason of participating of an activity, but that person is just going with the flow. He has no motivation actually, right? So the motivation is divided into three types: extrinsic motivation, intrinsic motivation, and emotivation. We have understood. We have understood what is motivation. We have understood what is motivational process. We have understood the different types of motivation. तो मोस्ट ऑफ द टाइम्स क्या होता है, बहुत सारे मेरे फ्रेंड्स हैं जो कि फिजिकल एजुकेशन टीचर्स हैं, वो क्या करते हैं कि वो बोलते हैं कि ठीक है, आपने हमें समझा दिया कि मोटिवेशन क्या है, आपने हमें ये भी समझा दिया कि मोटिवेशन कितने तरह के होते हैं, आपने हमें ये भी समझा दिया कि मोटिवेशनल प्रोसेस क्या होता है, बट वॉट नेक्स्ट. हम जब स्कूल में जाते हैं, when we go to ground, हाउ वी कैन मोटिवेट आवर स्टूडेंट. हम हमारे स्टूडेंट्स को कैसे मोटिवेट कर सकते हैं, हम हमारे स्टूडेंट्स को जो है उनको ट्रैक पे कैसे ला सकते हैं. तो आपका आंसर जो है, मैंने नेक्स्ट स्लाइड में आई हैव एक्सप्लेन्ड इट ऑन द बेसिस ऑफ फाइव बेसिक गाइडलाइंस. आपको ये पांच गाइडलाइंस आपको समझना पड़ेगा इफ टू मोटिवेट योर चिल्ड्रेन और टू ब्रिंग योर चिल्ड्रेन टू द ग्राउंड. सो द फर्स्ट पॉइंट हियर इज, the first guideline is, consider both situation and traits in monitoring, in motivating people. See, most of the times what happens, you know, when we draw a motivational judgment about an individual, we say that we just bring out a general statement that this particular individual is very much interested in physical education and sports, or that individual is not at all interested in physical education and sports on the basis of just a situational factor. So, ये चीज आप प्लीज ध्यान में रखिए. जब आप कोई बच्चे का, कोई बंदे का, यू नो, व्हेन यू आर ट्राइंग टू मेजर द लेवल ऑफ मोटिवेशन ऑफ एन इंडिविजुअल, यू प्लीज डू नॉट ड्रॉ एनी कंक्लूसिव स्टेटमेंट ओनली ऑन द बेसिस ऑफ इट्स यू नो स्टेटस और सिचुएशंस. सो यू ऑल्सो हैव टू टेक दैट पर्सन्स मोटिवेशनल लेवल एज ए यू नो एज पर्सनैलिटी इन टू कंसिडरेशन, हिज ट्रेट्स इन टू कंसिडरेशन. सो व्हाट यू टू डू इज, the motivation level may change over time. You should continue to monitor people's motives for participation even months after they have begun. So what happens when I was in my class days, I wanted to become an IAS officer. When I you know have joined my BP, I finished my BP. I entered into MP. I finished my MP. I always wanted to be a sports scientist. But see, why I'm saying all these things? Because with the age, you know, the motivation of an individual, you know, or the priority of an individual in life also changes, right? So what happens once you, as a physical education teacher, you have to go about developing. You have to go about, you know, continuously measuring the level of fitness of an individual by keeping in mind the trait factor, the personality factor, and also the situational factor. So when you are, you know, trying to study about the motivation of an individual, aapko kya karna padega? Aapko uska situational aspect, yeah, environmental aspect bhi dekhna padega, and in addition, aapko us bande ka jo personality aspect hai, wo bhi dekhna padega. Let us move on to the guideline 2. The second guideline says, understand people's multiple motives for involvement. See, आपको क्या करना पड़ेगा कि आपको सबसे पहले ढूंढना पड़ेगा कि क्या क्या reasons हैं. Not only one reason why that individual is participating or not participating in sports. You have to find out all the possible reasons that why one physical education or why a student is participating in physical education and sports, or why a student is participating in regular training in sports. Right? Now let us move on to the guideline 3. Change the environment to enhance motivation. See, this is a very valid point which everybody has to keep in mind. So what happens, you know, agar aap har roz aapko agar chicken biryani ya roti ke sath chicken milega ya dal sambar roti milega, dal sambar chawal milega, you know, if you go on eating the same kind of food, similar kind of food for a long time, after some days what will happen, aapko bore, matlab you will get bored to it. Right. So what I mean to say is the environmental change or the enhancement in the environment also will contribute to the, to your motivation. Like for an example, when I was a student, we used to go for, you know, serious training. Sometimes we used to go for, you know, trials. Sometimes we used to go for, you know, competition trials. We used to go for sand running. So by doing so, what happens? There is a change of environment. And when there is a change of environment, you know, it doesn't become monotonous, right? So that means we'll be highly motivated to participate in this kind of physical activity wherein there is a change of environment. So aapko kya karna padega, aapke jo player hain ya aapke jo students hain, unko jis environment mein aap training dete hain, aapko us environment mein thoda bahut mix up karna padega, and it has to be a perfect blend of your practice, recreation, competition, and your training. So all these things has to be perfectly blended together so that you can motivate your athlete to participate. Now this guide, now we'll move on to the guideline for influence motivation. See, influence motivation means you have to have an influence on your student's motivation. And how can you do that? You have to be a role model to your students. Now if I recall my college days, we had a coach namely Sri Pinto J. Ribello. He was a very good coach. You know, by seeing him, we were very much influenced. I mean, we always wanted to talk like him. We always wanted to be like him, run like him, perform like him. And above all, we always wanted to be an individual like him. So he influenced us in such a great manner that we wanted to be like him. That he influenced us in such a way that we were just waiting for his class. So you have to bring such a change in your, you have to be a role model to your student. And by doing so, you can motivate your children or you can motivate your students so that they come to the ground, they participate themselves. Because when, you know, as the saying goes, when you crack an egg with an external force, the life ends. When the egg cracks with an internal force, life begins. So similarly, आपको क्या क्या करना पड़ेगा, when you have to influence the child so that he is interested and he comes to you asking that, sir, I want to participate, I want to play, I want to participate in different games and sports. So this guideline 4 is most important among all these 5 guidelines. Now moving on to the last guideline, that is use behavior modification to change undesirable participant motives. This is also correct. Use behavioral modification techniques to change undesirable motives and strengthen weak motivations. Okay, so we have understood what is motivation, motivational process, and types of motivation, and what are the guidelines by which, using which we can build motivation among our children or among our students. Now let us go about goal setting. Goal setting, you know, as the name goes, goal setting means setting objectives or setting goals in our life or in our sports or in our day-to-day life, right? So this, you might be asking this question to yourself, why we should set goals in sports? What is the importance of goal setting in sports? In just, main aapko ek simple sentence mein main aapko bataunga, agar main aapko bolunga ki sir, chalte hain, I mean, let us go. If I just tell you, let us go, you should be asking me a question, where to, kahan jayenge? तो अगर मैंने आपको बता दिया कि हम लोग इस जगह पे जाने वाले हैं, वी आर गोइंग टू गो टू दिस प्लेस, तो क्या होगा कि आपके मन में द थिंग्स और योर कोर्स ऑफ एक्शन विल बी वेरी क्लियर कि हमें इस जगह पे जाना है. दैट मींस अगर आप गोल सेटिंग लाइफ में, व्हेन यू सेट गोल्स, योर एक्टिविटीज इन योर लाइफ बिकम्स वेरी मच डायरेक्टेड टुवर्ड्स योर गोल. आप फिर इधर उधर नहीं जाएंगे. यू डू नॉट गो फॉर एनी हियर एंड देयर मोमेंट. यू जस्ट फोकस योर ऑल द एक्टिविटीज. You channelize all the activities so that you can achieve your goal in a given period of time. So by setting goals, what we do is we influence the performance by directing athletes' attention towards relevant tasks and increasing persistence in the face of obstacles. So the reason why we have included this goal setting portion in this session, because goal setting is one of the most important thing that you have to keep in mind when you are dealing with your athlete. A goal is very much important, not only in sports, आपको in day-to-day life में भी goal setting की बहुत जरूरत है. क्यों जरूरत है sports में? क्योंकि आपको अगर आप नीचे दिया गया जो fact one and fact two लिखा है, इसमें अगर आप देखेंगे तो 80% of the studies जो कि 2007 तक पब्लिश हुए हैं indicates that goal setting facilitated improve in motor performance. क्यों motor performance को उसने facilitate किया? क्योंकि when you know your goals, when you know where you are going, the journey becomes enjoyable. That means अगर आपको पता है कि आपको क्या अचीव करना है तो आपका ट्रेनिंग बहुत आसान हो जाता है. इट बिकम्स वेरी मच ऑब्जेक्टिव. एंड द सेकेंड फैक्ट इज, आप जितने सारे ओलंपिक एथलीट हैं, जितने सारे आपका इलीट एथलीट्स हैं, इलीट परफॉर्मर्स हैं आपके ऑल ओवर द वर्ल्ड, एन इंडिविजुअल स्विमर लाइक यू नो माइकल फेल्प्स, he very openly has admitted how this goal setting has helped him when he was going through his bad days, that is when he was under a lot of stress. So these, you know, say these two facts justifies why we must be having a goal in our physical, in our sports. Now we have understood what is goal setting, we have understood we have justified why we need a goal setting in games and sports. Now we have to move on. We will learn different types of goals. There are three different types of goals, you know, we use in sport, games and sports. First one is your process goal, second one is your performance goal, third one is your outcome goal. Now see, if now first we will discuss about the process goal. In the process goal, what happens when we are actually, suppose for an example, if I am interested, if I want to become a national medalist in discus throw. Discus throw is my event, and I want to become a very good discus thrower or a national medalist in the event of discus throw. So what I want to do, what are the various things I need to pay attention to? मुझे सबसे पहले मेरा physical activity, physical जो abilities है, like strength improve करना पड़ेगा. I have to improve my strength, I'll have to improve my speed, I'll have to improve my skills and techniques. All these things are, you know, small things which is very much essential to achieve the ultimate goal. Or yahan pe ultimate goal kya hai? What is the ultimate goal? My ultimate goal is to become national medalist in the event of discus throw. To mujhe kya karna padega? Here what I'll do is I will go about, you know, achieving very small goals which will contribute towards my ultimate performance. And achieving those small goals are called as your process goals. Process goals are the goals which focus on learning the skills and techniques that is necessary to accomplish a goal. Right? Now we'll move on to the performance goal. Performance goals are related to execution during the game time. That means around the year, throughout the year, you have been training, you have been accomplishing all those small goals, you are achieving process goals. So ultimately, during the time of competition, you have to fix up a goal to yourself. Suppose if I'm doing a discus throw, if I want to be a national thrower in the state, so now for me, performance goal will be in the state level performance, in the state level championship, I am going to throw a distance of 50 meters. Now this is my performance goal. This is in any of the competitions when I'm putting a goal to myself, I'm putting a target to myself, those kind of targets, objectives are called as your performance goals. Okay, Now let us move on to the outcome goals. Outcome goals are the ultimate goal that you have fixed up in the beginning of your training. यहाँ पे क्या है, मेरा अल्टीमेट गोल क्या था, यहाँ पे मेरा अल्टीमेट गोल था कि मुझे नेशनल मेडलिस्ट बनना है इन द इवेंट ऑफ डिस्कस थ्रो. तो आउटकम गोल में क्या होगा, ये है मेरा आउटकम गोल जो कि मेरा अल्टीमेट गोल होता है. आउटकम गोल्स आर द डिजायर्ड फिनिश लाइन इन गोल सेटिंग. तो प्रोसेस गोल होते हैं जो छोटे छोटे गोल्स होते हैं जो कि हमें अचीव करना रहता है टू अचीव ए अल्टीमेट गोल. परफॉर्मेंस गोल क्या होता है, जो कि स्पोर्ट्स कंपटीशन में व्हाट एवर परफॉर्मेंस वी आर गिविंग और व्हाट एवर द टारगेट्स वी हैव फिक्स्ड अप ऑन द बेसिस so far as our performance is concerned, that is called as your performance goal. And outcome goal is what is our target or what we want to achieve ultimately. This outcome goal is our ultimate goal, and these are desired finish line in goal setting. So we have understood goal, we have understood why goal setting is required, we have understood three different types of goal, that is process, performance and outcome. Now we'll move on to the next slide, the principles of goal setting. ये जो principles of goal setting, ये मैं इसलिए आपको ऐसा discussion करना चाहता हूँ क्योंकि बहुत सारे लोग ऐसे भी पूछते हैं कि जैसे कि मैंने आपको motivation में बताया था, similarly in goal setting में आपने तो goal setting सिखा दिया, goal setting क्या है, goals क्या है, different types of goals क्या है, सबको सिखा दिया, but हम कैसे goal setting कैसे करेंगे, how do we set goals? तो ये जो प्रोसेस है, when you follow these processes, you can fix up a goal for your own self, right? So what is the first and most important the principle of goal setting is set specific goals. आप specific goal set करेंगे. आप कैसे specific goal set करेंगे? जैसे कि मैंने वही same example I would like to give here also in this case also. अगर मैं ये बोलता हूँ, if I say that I want to be a national player. I want to be a national player in discus throw, but this is not clear. In this, if I say that I want to be a national gold medalist in discus throw, now this goal is much more clear because the objective, what I want to achieve, what I need to achieve, is very clearly written when I'm saying that I want to achieve a gold medal in discus throw at national level. So that's how the first step and the most important step is you have to make your athlete understand very objectively, very pinpointly. Very particularly you have to make him understand कि वो क्या अचीव करना चाहता है और उससे क्या एक्सपेक्टेड है. सो यू हैव टू गो फॉर सेटिंग अ वेरी स्पेसिफिक गोल इंस्टेड ऑफ गोइंग फॉर द गोल्स व्हिच इज wherein द ऑब्जेक्टिव इज नॉट वेरी क्लियर. दैट इज द फर्स्ट प्रिंसिपल ऑफ गोल सेटिंग. नाउ वी मूव ऑन टू द नेक्स्ट प्रिंसिपल ऑफ गोल सेटिंग. सेट मॉडरेटली डिफिकल्ट बट रियलिस्टिक गोल्स. Right. So, this is a very important, point of our principle of goal setting. In this principle, what happens if, as a coach or a physical education teacher, when अगर आप आपके athlete को बोलते हैं, अगर मुझे समझ लीजिए कि मैं आपका, आप मेरे coach हैं और मैं आपके under training करता हूँ और मुझे training शुरू किए, games, the event शुरू किए, it's just only been a month, I started my physical activity or I started my serious training for discus throw. And as a coach, what you are saying that you are telling me that within 2 years, I want you to play for India in Olympics. Is possible? This is not possible. This is not moderately difficult. This is very difficult. This is, literally impossible. Within 2 years, you cannot make me world champion, right? It takes time. So another, this is one side. The another side is you are fixing a very easy goal for me. I have just participated. It's been a month. I have been doing this discus throw, and you want me to stand. You want me to achieve a gold medal in panchayat level meet. This is very easy. So when you are setting a goal, the goal has to be moderately difficult. That means it's not so difficult. It should not be so difficult that you are never able to achieve it. It's impossible, and it should not be so easy that you literally need no effort to achieve it. Right? So whenever you are fixing a goal for your athletes or your students, that goal has to be moderately difficult and realistic. That means achievable. Okay. Now we'll move on to the next principle of goal setting, which says set long and short term goals. That means whenever you are preparing your goals, it has to be a perfect blend of your long term goals and short term goals. Long term goals are, any goals which you have set, like there are, weekly goals, there are monthly goals, quarterly goals, yearly goals. So all these long and short term goals has to be combined together in your process of goal setting. Next principle is set performance, process, and as well as outcome goals. We have discussed these three different. हमने ये तीन जो तरीके के your goal setting goals हैं, your process, outcome, and your performance goals हैं. इसके बारे में हम लोगों ने previous slide में discuss किया है. And ये जो तीनों तरीके के goals हैं, इसको भी आप अपने principles of goal setting में add करेंगे. मतलब goal setting procedure में add करेंगे. So next principle of goal setting is set practice and competition goals. इसमें क्या होता है? See, many of the physical education teachers and coaches also will agree with me. If an individual is giving a performance in his practice session, it's not necessary that the same individual will give similar kind of performance during his competition time, right? What happens, you know, when an individual go and practice in a competition, there are many negative aspects, there are many detrimental factors which is coming into play, and thereby that affects you, that affects the performance of an athlete directly or indirectly. So that is why when you are setting goals for your athlete, practice goals or maybe competition goals, you have to be extra careful. You have to understand the demands during practice. You have to understand the factors, the psychological factors involved during the competitions. And taking all these two things into consideration, along with the ability of your athlete, you have to fix up the goals, right? So, and now what happens? Record the goals. This is another principle. This is the next principle of goal setting. Record the goals means what happens? You can motivate your athlete to maintain a diary. And you also are equally responsible to maintain a diary wherein your goals are recorded and your progress is also recorded. Your what is the target you wanted to achieve? How much you have achieved? If you have not been able to achieve that target, what are the reasons? So all these things has to be thoroughly recorded and noted down in a diary. And we'll move on to the next principles of goal setting, that is develop goal achievement strategies. See, just putting your athlete into a process of goal setting and not helping him or not providing him the strategies to achieve the goal will not solve the purpose. So you have to fix up a goal for your athlete by taking athlete into consideration, and at the same time aapko athlete matlab wo goal achieve karne ke liye kya kya strategies apnana padega wo bhi aapko decide karna padega, and you will have to provide the same information to your athlete. Okay, now we'll move on to the next principle of goal setting, which is consider the participant's personality and motivation. If an athlete is not interested, if you don't realize the level of the personality characteristics of your athlete, then this goal setting procedure is definitely going to fail during the process in the midway, right? So what you have to do is aapko isliye sab har baar aapko ye cheez dhyan rakhna padega. Aap jab goal banate hain, when you are setting a goal for your athlete, you don't set a goal all alone. आप उसको जस्ट ऑब्जर्व करके उसके लिए गोल्स बना के गोल सेट करके एक पेपर में लिख के आप उसको पकड़ा देंगे, नहीं. यू आर नॉट गोइंग टू डू दैट. सो इफ यू आर डूइंग दैट, इफ यू आर जस्ट प्रिपेयरिंग द गोल्स फॉर योर एथलीट जस्ट बाय ऑब्जर्विंग हिम, देन लिटरली व्हाट यू आर डूइंग इज यू आर आस्किंग योर एथलीट टू अचीव योर गोल्स व्हिच इज नॉट हिज. इट्स नॉट हिज गोल बिकॉज यू हैव नॉट कंसल्टेड हिम, यू हैव नॉट स्पोकन टू हिम, राइट. अगर आप उनसे बात नहीं किए हैं, आप उनको कंसिडरेशन में नहीं लिए हैं, आपको उनको पर्सनैलिटी के बारे में पता नहीं है, यू डोंट नो द काइंड ऑफ मोटिवेशन योर एथलीट इज फॉलोइंग और एक्सेप्टेड. सी, यू विल नेवर बी एबल टू चार्ट आउट एन इफेक्टिव प्रोसीजर ऑफ गोल सेटिंग, एंड योर गोल सेटिंग इज गोइंग टू फेल इन द मिड वे. तो ये चीज आपको ध्यान रखना पड़ेगा, आपके एथलीट को कंसिडरेशन में लेना पड़ेगा, उसका पर्सनैलिटी, उसका लेवल ऑफ मोटिवेशन को जान के समझ के उसके लिए बोलते रहना. Okay, now we'll move on to the next principle of goal setting. Foster an individual's goal commitment. आपको जो एक individual है, how committed he is towards the goal, ये भी आपको judge करना पड़ेगा. Because this is the problem happens, ये point I'll just explain in the next slide also. This point my fellow physical education teachers also will agree, even the coaches also will agree with me, that when the biggest problem comes, when the child is willing to participate, but he is not able to participate. That means a child is interested to participate in games and sports, but due to some kind of pressure, let it be exam, let it be from the family, let it be from the society, academics, anything. But due to some reason, he is not able to participate in the games and sports, and that is why he is not able to go with the procedure that you have fixed up during the goal setting procedure. So isme kya karna padega, how you can help your athlete towards towards this aspect, how can he be committed towards the goal that you have set. Next point is principles of goal setting is provide goal support. Yes, you have to support him during the process. You have to realize, you have to understand him, you have to understand his problems. So all these things, this kind of support you are going to provide. And the last point of principle of goal setting is you are provide evaluation of and feedback about the goals. Yes, you need to provide evaluation, you need to provide your feedback. Aapko feedback bhi dena padega ki ek athlete jo hai during the training karke, आप जो ट्रेनिंग कर रहे हैं उस ट्रेनिंग में कितना इफेक्ट आ रहा है, कितना चेंजेस आ रहे हैं उसके स्किल में, कितना चेंजेस आ रहे हैं उनके परफॉर्मेंस में. अगर इफ ही इज गेटिंग एनी काइंड ऑफ चेंजेस इन हिज परफॉर्मेंस देन इट्स फाइन. इफ ही इज नॉट गेटिंग देन व्हाट इज द नेक्स्ट थिंग दैट हैज टू बी डन, व्हाट आर द यू नो ट्रेनिंग प्रोग्राम्स, व्हाट आर द डिफरेंट काइंड्स ऑफ मेथड्स दैट कैन बी included so that your athlete gives you all these best performance. So all these principles you have to keep in your mind when you are formulating goals for your athlete. So these are the principles or golden principles of goal setting. Yeah, now in this slide I would be talking about the diagram on the left hand side top corner and the diagram on right hand side top corner. So first let us discuss about the diagram on the left hand side. So pay your attention to the diagram on the left hand side top corner. Yeah, so this is what happens, you know, whenever you have fixed up a goal for your own athlete, what happens, everything is perfectly fine and your athlete is training regularly and his progress is also as expected, but suddenly what happens, he is injured. Usme injury, usko injury ho jata hai, ya to wo exams aa jate hain, wo bahut din ke liye, matlab 12th exam aa jate hain ya 10th board exam aa jate hain, owing to which you know he is not able to come to the ground. So in that thing you cannot force him to come to the ground. So when whenever an athlete is injured, the first thing that you do is you will take him away from the ground, you will keep him away from the ground. So when you keep him away from the ground for around, you know, 7 to 8 weeks or 8 to 10 weeks, what happens, his physical abilities are down. So when his physical abilities are down, so can he continue with the same goal which you have fixed earlier? No, the answer is no. वो उसी सेम गोल को कंटिन्यू नहीं कर सकते हैं क्योंकि दैट गोल वाज डिसाइडेड ऑन द बेसिस ऑफ हिज फिजिकल एबिलिटी व्हिच वाज मच बेटर बट नाउ आफ्टर द इंजरी आफ्टर द रिकवरी हिज फिजिकल लेवल इज नॉट द सेम व्हाट इट यूज्ड टू बी. तो अभी आपको क्या करना पड़ेगा, नाउ यू हैव टू स्प्लिट और ब्रेक डाउन योर अल्टीमेट गोल इनटू स्मॉल 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 सब गोल्स. सो व्हेन ही गो अबाउट यू नो अचीविंग ऑल दिस सब गोल्स अल्टीमेटली ही रीचेस goal. So what I basically want to say is if you have fixed up a goal and due to any reason if your athlete is not able to come for practice, don't worry, don't panic, but as and when your athlete is available, you review your ultimate goal which you have fixed up earlier, you modify it, and on the basis of the modification of the goal you can just fix up some sub goals. When your athlete go on achieving the sub goals, ultimately he will end up in the final goal. Okay, now shift your attention towards the right hand top corner of the diagram, which is at the right hand top corner, that is smart goal. So whenever you are fixing up a goal for your athlete or for your player, you have to set goals smartly. So what is the meaning of this smart? S stands for specific. Yes, we have discussed in the previous slide. M, measurable. Yes, your goal has to be measurable, otherwise how will you know that, how far you have reached, whether you have been able to achieve your goal? So you have to quantify your goal in terms of distance, in terms of time, in terms of you know number of matches won or number of baskets that you have scored during a match. So all these things, it has to be your goals that you have set. It has to be measurable. It has to be action oriented. It has to be realistic. And the next point is it has to be timely. Timely means whatever goals you are setting, there has to be a time limit for it. आप अगर गोल सेट करते हैं तो देयर हैज टू बी अ टाइम लिमिट, का मतलब कितने दिन में आप उस गोल को अचीव करेंगे, 2 महीने, 3 महीने, 4 महीने, 5 months, 6 months, within what time you are going to achieve that goal, that also you will have to mention. Self-determined goals. Goals should be set by or have input from the participant. That also we have discussed. So with this, we have discussed what are the different types of goals. We discussed about the what are the you know principles of goal setting. Then also we discussed whenever there is an injury, how can we continue with the goal setting. Now let us move on to the concentration. Now, before we go about, you know, just discussing formally about the concentration, there are around more than 1200 participants listening to me right now. So I want to ask you a question that, I mean, I'm just talking to you all, you are just able to listen to my voice, but is this the only thing happening around you? No, it is not the only thing happening around you. Like there may be fans, working around you, there may be lights on, or somebody may be talking outside, or maybe a dog is barking outside. So there are so many things happening around, but at present, you may not be aware about it because you are listening to me. अभी आप मुझे सुन रहे हैं, मेरे बात सुन रहे हैं, तो इसलिए आप मेरे वॉइस को अटेंशन दे रहे हैं. दैट मींस यू आर पेइंग योर अटेंशन, दैट मींस यू आर फोकसिंग योर ऑन माय वॉइस, ऑन माय टॉक. सो दिस इज व्हाट इज कॉल्ड एज कंसंट्रेशन. कंसंट्रेशन इज द एबिलिटी टू मेंटेन फोकस ऑन रिलेवेंट एनवायरमेंटल क्यूज और रिलेवेंट एनवायरमेंटल इंफॉर्मेशन. दैट मींस व्हेन यू आर एबल टू लिसन सो मेनी थिंग्स, but you, by avoiding all those unnecessary things, you pay focus or you pay attention or you pay concentration to certain kind of information, that is called as your concentration or attentional focus, right? So this concentration is again divided into four types on the basis of width and on the basis of direction. On the basis of width, it is divided into two types. On the basis of direction, isko humne do tarike mein divide kiya hai. तो विड्थ के बेसिस पे हमने जो डिवाइड किया है वो डिवीजन को हम बोलते हैं ब्रॉड डिवीजन एंड नैरो, ब्रॉड कंसंट्रेशन एंड नैरो कंसंट्रेशन. ब्रॉड कंसंट्रेशन किसको बोलते हैं? देखिए, जब आप फुटबॉल खेलते हैं, मे बी फॉर एन एग्जांपल, जब आप बास्केटबॉल खेलते हैं, ठीक है, तो बास्केटबॉल में क्या होता है, आपको आपके ओपोनेंट को डिफेंड करके आपके टीममेट को पास देना है. तो इसलिए आपको क्या करना पड़ेगा, आपको आपके जो टीममेट है यानी जो फ्रेंड है उसका पोजीशन में तो जानना जरूरी है ही, बट इन एडिशन आपको जो ओपोनेंट का पोजीशनिंग क्या है, क्या आपको बॉल पास, जब तक आप बॉल पास करेंगे तब तक ओपोनेंट वहां तक पहुंच जाएगा या नहीं, ये सारी चीजें आपको इवैल्यूएट करना पड़ेगा. दैट मींस नाउ यू आर कीपिंग योर अटेंशन और यू आर जस्ट फोकसिंग और कंसंट्रेटिंग ऑन सो मेनी इंडिविजुअल्स हु आर स्टैंडिंग इन फ्रंट ऑफ यू. So this kind of concentration or this kind of attentional focus is called as broad attentional focus or broad concentration. Next one is narrow. In narrow, this concentration, what happens, for an example, when you are playing golf or when you are playing this snooker billiards, so that time, you know, you have to pay your attention on a very small object, only one object, that is the snooker ball, right? So when you are paying attention to that, your concentration, or when you are paying focus to it, your concentration becomes narrow. This is the division on the basis of width. Now we'll move on to the division of the concentration on the basis of direction. Direction mein kya hota hai, ek cheez hai external, ek cheez hai internal. So external concentration kya hai, when you pay concentration or when you pay focus on anything outside your body, aap kisi मतलब कोई फुटबॉल पे देख रहे हैं, दैट इज योर एक्सटर्नल कंसंट्रेशन. रास्ते में कोई गाड़ी जा रहे हैं आप देख रहे हैं, दैट इज योर एक्सटर्नल कंसंट्रेशन. आप बैटिंग कर रहे हैं, बॉलर आ रहा है बॉलिंग करने के लिए, आप बॉलर पे फोकस कर रहे हैं, दैट इज योर एक्सटर्नल कंसंट्रेशन. बट देन व्हाट इज इंटरनल कंसंट्रेशन? इंटरनल कंसंट्रेशन इज व्हेन यू आर फोकसिंग योर सेल्फ. आप देखे होंगे बहुत सारे एथलीट हैं, लाइक योर येलेना इसनबायेवा एंड योर सेरेना विलियम्स. सो ऑल दीज प्लेयर्स, यू नो, व्हेन दे गो फॉर playing, taking a stroke, or when they go for, you know, attempting a jump or something, they talk to themselves. Even Yelena Isinbayeva has, you know, she talks to her own hole. So they talk to themselves. So when they are talking to themselves, what basically they are doing is they are trying to focus within. Wo log mental rehearsal use karke, they are trying to focus within. They are trying to concentrate on the task that is at hand or how they can play better by avoiding all the unnecessary external disturbances. Okay, abhi kya hai, abhi jaise aap logo ne, maine sab jitne bhi yahan pe physical education teachers hain, bahut sare ke mann mein ye question hogi ki sir कंसेंट्रेशन तो समझ गए, बट ये जो कंसेंट्रेट कैसे करेंगे, हमारे जो प्लेयर्स हैं उनको कैसे मोटिवेट करेंगे, कैसे वो लोग अपना गेम एंड स्पोर्ट्स में कंसेंट्रेट कर पाएंगे? क्योंकि कंसेंट्रेटिंग इन डिफरेंट गेम्स एंड स्पोर्ट्स, यू नो, इफ आई आस्क यू टू कीप क्वाइट close your eyes, sit for 15 minutes. It is a difficult task. You know, your mind goes here and there physically, though physically you are there, but your mind goes here and there. So how can we develop a control over our mind? How can we, you know, bring back our mind to the task and focus by avoiding all the distractors? So whenever you go to a doctor, you know, doctor kya karte, what the doctor does, doctor will ask you for signs and symptoms. Then he will diagnose. On the basis of diagnosis, he will try to define the problem. After knowing the problem only, he will give you the solution. That means he will give you the medicines. So here also, we'll try to find out what are the attentional problems that an athlete is facing. So all the attentional problems that an athlete is facing during his performance can be studied under two headings. One is the attentional problems owing to internal distractors. The second one is attentional problems owing to your external distractors. So यहाँ पे क्या है, the external distractors जितने भी हैं, इनके ऊपर हमारा जो है ना, जो control थोड़ा कम है. क्यों कम है? इसीलिए कम है क्योंकि जो external distractor, मतलब जैसे कि crowd, हमारे stadium में जितने लोग बैठे हैं वो बहुत शोर मचाते हैं. Can we control that? It is very difficult to control that. और वहाँ पे जो crowd में जो है वो जोर जोर से चिल्लाते हैं, और आपने देखा होगा सब कैमरा फोटो लेना शुरू कर देते हैं. You know, in many of the places you might have seen, सारा जितने भी players हैं, सब लोग अपना जो mobile का flashlight on करके सब ऐसे wave करते हैं. We cannot control that. We have very less control over that, right? So हम लोग आज के session में, we are not going to discuss about external distractors. Rather, we will focus our attention on our internal distractors. देखिए, ये जो attending to past event and attending to future events हैं, ये दोनों हैं. These are very most of our athletes, you know, are affected by this. Attending to past event का मतलब है, जैसे कि for an example, I had a friend who was a long jumper and at a later stage who was a very good athlete, and at a later stage, you know, he went on to become a decathlete. So he had some kind of ankle injury. But when you have an ankle injury, any kind of injury, when you have an ankle injury, what happens even after you recover from that injury, you know, that fear factor still remains in your mind. Right, so whenever you are going to, you know, go for you have recovered, you got an injury, you recovered, now you want to come back to the sports. So when you want to come back to the sports, if you go on thinking about what happened in the past, and if you are not able to recover from the agony or the pain that you have gone through because of your injury, then that is going to affect your performance, right? So when during the present situation, during the performance, if you go on thinking about the past events, that will definitely affect your performance. So इसलिए आपको क्या करना पड़ेगा, आपके एथलीट को ये चीजें जो है ये कैसे भी करके कंट्रोल करना पड़ेगा, right? So attending to the future events, this ये जो चीज है attending to future events, I want to share one instance, you know, out of my own experience. So I during my college days, you know, I used to do discus throw. So during the discus throw, you know, for you must be knowing, everybody must be knowing. See, in discus throw, you get 6 chances. After 3 chances, you know, your position is reshuffled on the basis of performance, and you get 3 more chances, right? So after 3 chances, I used to be very happy, and if I come to know that I am in top 2 or I'm leading, then I used to become very happy. And that moment onwards, you know, my focus used to be on victory ceremony. My focus used to be on gold medal instead of focusing my attention on the skills, the techniques, or you know, throwing a good distance. So what happens, what used to happen is, so at the when the all the 6 throws are completed, my position goes down from first place to fourth place. So because, you know, immediately what happened, I instead of focusing in my present situation, I started thinking about the future. I am going to win, this is how I am going to be given gold medal. So my thinking is taken over by the future events, right? So this also creates problem in focusing. Choking under pressure, you all must be remembering the football match between Brazil and Germany in the 2014 World Cup, right? So the in that match, Brazil lost the match in 7-1. It was what went wrong. It was their own country. It was their own national stadium. It was the whole stadium was filled with yellow. It was completely yellow stadium. I mean, completely their own spectators, and they had star football players in their team. But then what went wrong? Why did they lose the match? they lost the match because they could not handle the pressure. And what kind of pressure? The pressure is when you are playing in your home country or when you are playing in your home ground. If you are playing well, the audience presence is positive. That puts a positive impact on your performance. But when you are playing in the home ground, but you are not playing up to the mark, then what happens? The presence of that your home audience becomes a pressure, and most of the times you will choke under that pressure. So that's what happened with the Brazil team. They choked under the pressure. They could not handle the pressure. That's why they collapsed and performed very badly. Over analyzing body mechanics mein kya hota hai ki you are so much worried, so much concerned about your skills, your techniques. Yes, you must be worried, but aapko itna bhi worried nahi hona chahiye ki wo aage chal ke aapka jo sports performance hai us pe usko affect kare, aur aage chal ke apna aapka jo itne saal ka jo mehnat hai us pe pani phir de. Theek hai, so you should be concerned about your tactics, but over analyzing your body mechanics and over analyzing your body techniques also is detrimental towards your focusing ability. Fatigue, everybody knows it, and to explain, agar ek athlete thaka hua hai, if an athlete is tired, then it becomes very difficult for him to pay attention or to pay focus or to be attentive towards his game and sports. Inadequate motivation, we discussed about that in the beginning. So these are the internal distractors that affect your concentration. Now I have given you, as I told you, a doctor first diagnosis. We have diagnosed it, we have just found out what are the problems. Now the point comes, what are the solution, how can we solve it, right? So yahan pe dekhiye ki there are two things here. Self talk, first, the self talk is when we talk to yourself, when you are talking to yourself as an outsider. So you, when you are talking to yourself, that means you are engaging in self talk technique of sports psychology. So this self talk can be of again two types. One is negative self talk, second one is positive self talk. As a coach, as a physical education trainer, aapko har baar ye dhyan dena chahiye ki your athlete is involved in self talk, point one, but should be involved in positive self talk, point two. That means, see, if you see the first diagram here, a girl is playing tennis. She has missed a very important shot. She could not take it, so she lost the point. So after losing that point, she can say two things to her. First thing is, what an idiot I am, I will never win now. Iska matlab kya hai, ye bahut maine bahut foolish wala mistake kiya hai aur is mistake ke chalte main abhi jeet nahi paunga, I am lost. To isme kya hai, she has created a label or created a limit to herself. Now she is telling herself that I cannot win. That means she is creating a negative kind of environment around her. But whereas if you see the second statement, keep your eyes on the ball, this match is not over. Iska matlab kya hai, dhyan rakho ball pe, dhyan rakho game pe, dhyan rakho game abhi tak khatam nahi hua. Iska matlab ye hai ki wo khud ko apne ko samjha rahi hai. She is trying to bring her complete focus to the game again. Aur yahan pe ye positive self talk dene se kya hota hai, aapka jo focus hai aur aapka jo concentration hai, that becomes much better. तो ये जो सबसे इजी तरीका है जो आपके कंसंट्रेशन या फोकस को रखने के लिए, कंट्रोल में रखने के लिए, द इजीएस्ट मेथड इज सेल्फ टॉक. व्हाट काइंड ऑफ सेल्फ टॉक? इट हैज टू बी ए पॉजिटिव सेल्फ टॉक. व्हाई इट हैज टू बी ए पॉजिटिव सेल्फ टॉक? बिकॉज पॉजिटिव सेल्फ टॉक्स विल कीप यू ऑन ट्रैक, एंड द नेगेटिव सेल्फ टॉक विल डेवलप लॉट ऑफ प्रेशर ऑन यू, लॉट ऑफ स्ट्रेस ऑन यू, एंड अल्टीमेटली यू विल ब्रेक डाउन. सो सिमिलरली इफ यू सी द इन द नेक्स्ट डायग्राम आप देखेंगे, वहां पे एक बंदे को नी इंजुरी लगा है, और नी इंजुरी में जब लगा है, व्हेन ही इज टेकिंग रेस्ट, खुद को क्या बोल रहा है कि आई विल नेवर गेट बैक इन द स्टार्टिंग लाइनअप. मतलब ये इंजुरी हो गया, मेरा करियर अभी खत्म है, मैं आगे इससे रिकवर करके आगे इंजुरी नहीं आ सकता. इफ यू थिंक लाइक दैट, देन अल्टीमेटली योर ब्रेन इज वेरी अडेप्टिव. योर ब्रेन विल कन्वे यू द सिमिलर काइंड ऑफ इन्फॉर्मेशन, विल मेक यू फील लाइक दैट. ठीक है ना, तो आप उसको पॉजिटिव में कन्वर्ट कर सकते हैं. कैसे बोलेंगे, दिस टाइप ऑफ इंजरी जस्ट टेक्स टाइम टू हील, सो आई नीड टू कंटिन्यू टू वर्क हार्ड, राइट? तो ये था आपका, दिस इज अबाउट योर पॉजिटिव सेल्फ टॉक एंड नेगेटिव सेल्फ टॉक. इन एडिशन टू दिस ऑल्सो देर आर वेरियस अदर मेथड्स बाय फॉर एनहांसिंग कंसेंट्रेशन. सो वाई आई हैव इंक्लूडेड ओनली 8 मेथड्स हियर, दो देर आर सो मेनी, बट ऑन फील्ड मेथड मीन्स इफ यू आर यूजिंग ऑल दीज 8 मेथड्स, you need not to you need not to go for, I mean, in all these 8 techniques, you know, this financial burden is not involved. All these things are on field techniques which can be used or which can be done without any equipment. So if I just tell you, because I know for the physical education teachers in schools, purchasing an equipment of, you know, lakhs of rupees is not very easy, right? So that is why these 8, you can make use of all these 8 techniques which have been mentioned on the website. That is use of simulation practice, use of keywords, use of non-judgmental thinking, establish routines, develop competition plan, develop eye control, monitor yourself, overlearn the skills. So these are the different methods for enhancing concentration. So you can use all these methods on field techniques, without any financial burden involved. You, by using all these techniques, you can enhance the concentration ability of your athlete. Yeah, next comes the aggression in sport. Aggression in sport is, when you see this diagram, you know, just forget about the definition which is written at the center. But one thing which is common in all the photos, if you see that, everybody is involved in harming the next participant. Let it be your physical harm, let it be your psychological harm. Everybody in here is included, is indulged in harming the opponent. Okay, so that is why what happens when the main objective or the behavior which is called as aggression is when your behavior is targeted to causing harm to somebody, that kind of behavior is called as aggression. For an example, aap aur main hum log milke ek football match khel rahe hain. We are just playing a football match. So by mistake, when I'm tackling a ball, by mistake, my leg, means I kicked on your leg, by mistake. But what you, you know, perceived that I intentionally kicked on your leg. तो अभी आपके दिमाग में क्या आज मतलब अभी आपके दिमाग में क्या आ जाएगा कि ये बंदा मेरे पैर पे लात मारा है अभी नाउ नथिंग डूइंग आई एम गोइंग टू किक हिज लेग मुझे उसका पैर तोड़ना है तो अभी क्या है अभी आपका इंटेंशन अभी दिमाग में सबसे पहले क्या था आप समहाउ यू वांटेड टू विन द गेम अभी आपके दिमाग में क्या है अभी विन आप यू डोंट वांट टू कंसंट्रेट ऑन द गेम यू डोंट केयर अबाउट व्हेन द टीम इज गोइंग टू विन और लूज What you want to do is you want to take revenge of that opponent who kicked on your leg, right? So the aggression is defined as any behavior directed towards intentionally harming or injuring another living being. Okay. Now, abhi aggression kya hai? Hum logon ne samjha. Abhi now we'll go on to understand types of aggression. There are different types of aggression, right? So the first one, I'll give you two incidents. One incident I already told you. मुझे मैंने आपके football खेलते वक्त मेरा पैर आपके पैर पे लग गया. अभी नाउ ऑल दैट यू वांट इज यू वांट टू ब्रेक माय लेग बिकॉज यू परसेव दैट आई इंटेंशनली किक्ड ऑन योर लेग सो दिस इज हियर व्हाट हैपेंस आपका जो अल्टीमेट एम है आपका जो अल्टीमेट गोल यहाँ पे क्या है आपका अल्टीमेट गोल यहाँ पे है मेरे को इंजुरी पहुंचाना मेरे को हानि पहुंचाना जस्ट टू इंज्योर मी टू कॉज पेन टू कॉज हार्म टू मी आप अभी इस सिचुएशन में क्या करते हैं ना आप योर अल्टीमेट एम इज टू कॉज हार्म टू मी बट सो फार एज योर इंस्ट्रूमेंटल एग्रेशन इज कंसर्न यहाँ पे क्या होता है आई विल गिव यू अनदर एग्जाम्पल सपोज यू आर द कैप्टन ऑफ योर टीम राइट यू आर द कैप्टन ऑफ योर टीम एंड यू नो दैट द प्रेजेंट बैट्समैन हु इज बैटिंग एट द अदर एंड द प्रेजेंट बैट्समैन इफ ही इज आउट देन द कंप्लीट टीम विल कोलैप्स एंड यू विल वेरी इजिली विन द मैच सो व्हाट यू डिड यू वेंट क्वाइटली टू योर फास्टेस्ट बॉलर ऑफ योर टीम एंड यू टोल्ड हिम यू जस्ट गो एंड आई मीन बोल हिम बाउंसर एंड यू टारगेट हिज हेड Now what happens? That poor fellow, he doesn't have any enmity with the batsman, right? So, but what he did, he went and bowled a bouncer that hit on his head. He goes for retired hard, and the complete team collapse, and your team won the match. See, in this case, what happens? He used aggression. He caused harm to somebody to win a match. Just see the difference. In the first, in hostile aggression. You don't care whether you are going to win or lose the match. You just want to harm somebody, right? But in instrumental aggression, what happens? You want to win the match, right? But by using someone or by causing harm to someone, right? In the both this type of aggression, causing harm means present, but the ultimate goal is harm in hostile aggression. But in instrumental aggression, the ultimate goal is to win. Now, another kind of, it's not a kind of aggression, but rather it can be called as your assertive behavior. In this assertive behavior, what happens? You try to excel your skills, you try to make yourself better, you try to excel obey all the rules and regulations. So this is basically, you know, when you are trying your level best to dominate your opponent, that kind of behavior is called as assertive behavior, wherein you are exhibiting the best of the physical skills. You are very good at batting, you are very good at bowling, and you are very good at fielding, and you are able to manipulate all the rules and regulations correctly. That means you are completely dominating a game, and that kind of behavior is called as assertive behavior. And this kind of assertive behavior should be promoted among the sportsmen or among the athletes. But this hostile aggression and instrumental aggression should be avoided at any cost. Okay, now how to control aggression? As I told you, the first step is promote assertiveness, not aggressiveness among your athletes. The next step is athletes involved in aggressive act should be severely punished. Excuse me. Athletes involved in aggressive act should be severely punished. This means when an athlete is involved in any kind of, you know, aggressive act like punching somebody, spitting on the official, or maybe threatening some of the players, so that athlete should be punished severely. Let me tell you, if you are the manager or the coach of a team wherein the best player of your team is very aggressive or he doesn't obey any of your suggestions, so in that case, what you have to do is, if you have to take a tough call, that also you should be ready for it. You should not hesitate to take a tough call. That means dropping him continuously for 2-3 games, or talking to him to find out what is the reason why he is being very much aggressive. So all these things you have to keep in mind. But at the same time, coaches promoting the aggressive act should also not be spared. I'm not sure, correct me if I'm wrong, in the game of football, even there is a red card for the coaches, right? Even Dr. Gangwar can rectify if I'm wrong. Even there is a red card for the coaches in the game of football. That means if the coach is not obeying the rules and regulations, if he is being aggressive and misbehaving, then he also can be shown a red card and sent out, and he has no right to sit with the team members or the players in the team bench. And that should be done. You should not hesitate to take action against the coaches. Even official aggression also should be prevented. So all those officials involved in the games also should be given proper kind of training, proper kind of workshop, by means of which, you know, the harmful effects of this aggression or aggressive these acts can be controlled. And the last point, coping skills to deal with the aggression should be practiced. That means there are various psychological techniques which can be used to control the aggression of your players, of your athletes. So that also can be used in the form of psychological skill training. Next point we are going to discuss about is arousal aggression. And arousal is, you know, the first thing you need to understand anxiety. So the anxiety is a negative emotional state. So the moment I say it, it's a negative emotional state, that means all kind of negative emotional states are not good for your performance, your sports performance. So this anxiety is again divided into two types on the basis that is your cognitive anxiety, and the second one is your somatic anxiety. So whenever we are talking about your cognitive anxiety, what happens, any changes that occurs in our brain or your mental ability, our cognitive ability, whenever we are experiencing a stressful condition or when we are experiencing anxiety, that will come under your cognitive anxiety. And when you are facing anxiety, when you are under a lot of stress, what happens? There are certain physical changes. Kya kya physical changes hote hain? Aapke blood, blood pressure, aapka, your heartbeat badh jate hain, sweating hone lagte hain, aapka jo palm hai pura thand pad jate hain, aapka jo face ka color hota hai pura change ho jata hai, and your blood flow to increase ho jata hai. See, all these things are the response, the physical and physiological response of anxiety, which is again negative state of emotional, which is a negative emotional state. Aur ye sare components hamare study kiye jayenge under your somatic anxiety. So anxiety are of two types, which is, one is your cognitive anxiety, second one is your somatic anxiety. It is also classified in to trait anxiety and state anxiety. Trait anxiety is when an individual is anxious, or he is anxious by born. That means when anxiety becomes the characteristics of an individual or the personality characteristics of an individual, then that individual is driven by the state anxiety, not by the trait anxiety. Rather, state anxiety mein kya hota hai? हम कोई पर्टिकुलर सिचुएशन में कैसे बिहेव करते हैं उसको और हाउ स्ट्रेसफुल वी बिकम और हाउ एंग्जियस वी बिकम अंडर गिवन सर्कमस्टेंस दैट इज कॉल्ड एज योर ट्रेट आई मीन स्टेट एंग्जायटी इज टेम्पररी विच इज एवर चेंजिंग इमोशनल स्टेट ऑफ सब्जेक्टिव कॉन्शियस पर्सिव फीलिंग्स ऑफ अप्रेंशन एंड टेंशन इसको बोलते हैं हम लोग यू नो स्टेट एंग्जायटी और ट्रेट एंग्जायटी में क्या होता है ट्रेट एंग्जायटी इज an individual is by born anxious, usko hum bolte hain trait anxiety. Or state anxiety means it is situation specific and which is temporary. Yes, on this slide I would like to pay attention. I would like all of your attention on this slide. See, athlete A, what happens? He gives his best performance when his level of arousal is low, and the athlete B is giving his best performance when his level of arousal is medium. Athlete C is giving his best performance when the level of arousal is high, right? So normally, if you ask many of the coaches and teachers, physical education teachers, you know, they will say that the athlete gives his best performance when the level of arousal is optimum. But that's not true. There may be one athlete who is able to give his best performance when his level of arousal is low. Right. At the same time, an athlete can give his best performance. Another athlete can give his best performance when his level of arousal is moderate, and the third athlete is giving his best performance when his level of arousal is high. That means we need to understand, as a coach and teacher, we need to understand the characteristics of our athlete, or the psychological or the cognitive characteristic of our athlete, and on the basis of that, we need to find out on in which level of arousal our athlete is able to give his best performance. And we need to make sure that when our athlete is going for sports performance, our athlete should have that kind of or that level of arousal. Then only he will give his best performance. Okay, there are the various anxiety reduction techniques. First one is your progressive muscle relaxation. This progressive muscle relaxation is nothing but in a methodical manner. We try to relax the big muscles of our body, starting from your calf muscles, your quadriceps group of muscles, hamstring muscles, lower back, abdomen, chest, upper back, both the hands, chin, face, and head. So these ये सारे area में जो muscle को क्या करते हैं हम लोग big muscles जो हैं उनको contract करते हैं, relax करते हैं, and by accordingly we just go about relaxing our muscles. क्योंकि आपको पता होगा when an individual is under anxiety or under a lot of stress, उनके जो मसल्स हैं, जो बिग मसल्स हैं, उनमें स्टिफनेस ज्यादा हो जाता है. तो अगर हम लोग मसल को रिलैक्स करेंगे, स्टिफनेस को हटाएंगे, दैट विल कंट्रीब्यूट टुवर्ड्स द रिडक्शन ऑफ एंजाइटी. सेकंड वन इज ब्रीथ कंट्रोल. ब्रीदिंग आपके दो तरीके के होते हैं. पहला होता है आपका चेस्ट ब्रीदिंग, दूसरा होता है आपका एब्डोमिनल ब्रीदिंग. चेस्ट ब्रीदिंग इज ए सिंबल ऑफ योर एंजाइटी, एंड योर एब्डोमिनल ब्रीदिंग इज अ सिंबल ऑफ योर रिलैक्सेशन और रिलैक्स्ड. Okay, so if your athlete is breathing abdominally, if he's going for chest breathing, then you should be very much sure that your athlete is going through anxiety and there is something wrong. And immediately you can just tell him to go for your abdominal breathing, and that will reduce the stress. Biofeedback is a machine by using which we can just find out what is the level of stress in our different muscles, and muscles send different kind of waves, and those waves are displayed on a computer screen, and by seeing that we'll be able to find out which muscle is stressed, which muscle is tight, which muscle needs relaxation. And there are also different kinds of training: autogenic training, stress management training, and hypnosis. By doing all these techniques, by using all these six different techniques, we can reduce our anxiety. So with this, we have just come to the end. We have just come to the conclusion of this presentation. So now this presentation is open for discussion. If there is any query or if there is anything, you can ask me. We can take up questions. So just to summarize, for continuity in sports for an athlete, the coach must do the following. The first and most important thing, you must be knowing a quotation that one man can. One man can bring a horse into water, but 20 men cannot make him drink. That means If one individual is not motivated, if he is not interested, then he will not be actively participating in sports, and thereby what will happen? The active, when there is no interest, that individual will somehow, he will drop out when the time pass by. So the first and most important thing is motivate the athlete, do right goal setting, help athletes concentrate better. And another thing also, you need to, as a physical education teacher, you need to find out a solution to control the aggression. And last point, the ultimate thing is you need to make him or her feel comfortable and enjoy the game. That's the most important thing. We must promote a lifetime involvement in physical activity or games and sports. Thank you so much. We can take up now questions. Thank you.
Yeah, thank you so much, Astho sir, for a wonderful session. I know, and making the things very clear and very realistic, and that explanation that was really, you know, what to say, like, you know, it directly hit to the participants' need. And
thank you.
Now we'll take some questions, sir. As I mentioned, like, it was really understandable. Then, you know, the questions are, you can see a big list of questions is there. And they have very, you know, simple doubts as well. Okay, so quickly I'll just take one question, sir. Somebody just want to clarify that what is motivation in simple words? Like, you know, when we talk about the performance, when we talk about the continuity, and, you know, what exactly that motivation?
Okay, can you please repeat your question?
Please clarify motivation in simple words.
Yeah, motivation, see, it's very simple. As I told you in the very beginning, motivation, you know, that is the main force, you know, that is a pulling force, you know, which guides your efforts. Which guides your efforts towards achieving a goal. Like, for an example, now suppose I'm an athlete, right? I want to become a national medalist or maybe a All India University medalist in discus throw. So that is the goal, or that is what I want to achieve. That's it. So whatever the moments or whatever the activities now I'll be doing, all these activities will be guided by my that goal or by my that ultimate thing that I'm willing to achieve, right? So motivation means it's a force, you know, which push you or pull you towards your objective or towards the goal in your life.
Okay, thank you so much, sir. Yeah, now I'll take the next question. So, sir, please once again clarify about unsatisfied need.
What is that?
Please.
Unsatisfied need.
Unsatisfied need.
Yeah, unsatisfied need is something like, see, in a very simple word, I can just remove unsatisfied and I can just read write need only. That's, see, unsatisfied need means whenever we have a deficiency. Like, for an example, if we try to understand the concept of feeling hungry from a psychophysiological point of view, why do we feel hungry? Because when the blood glucose level in our body, you know, goes down, we feel hungry. So whenever the blood glucose level goes down, you know, our body sends a message to our brain that yes, now is the time we need to have food. That means when we take some food, the blood glucose level goes up and we start, you know, that feeling of hungry is removed. Okay, so when our brain gets a message that the blood glucose level is down and there is a deficiency and we need to have food. So that is the need. That is the deficiency in our body can be termed as unsatisfied needs.
Okay, thank you, sir. Sir, before taking next question, could you please stop sharing slides?
Yeah, sure.
Yeah. So, yeah, thank you. Now, sir, the next question is, like, when we are setting goals for children, so is there any difference between the boys and girls? I mean, like, is there any difference, or we can, you know, same goal we can set for the same age group of boys or girls, or, you know, something we have to consider before setting goal, especially for gender aspect, like, please.
Gangwar, sorry to interrupt. Can we ask our participants to write the questions in Q&A sections only? Because if you are writing the questions in chat section, it will be difficult for us to locate your question.
Sir, that question, if you see, you can see in chat box, that is, you know, I think in very initial stage of the session, third or fourth session is.
Yeah. So yeah. What is you were asking something?
Differentiate boys and girls goal setting plan. Is there
okay? See, there is no difference. There should not be any difference in the so far as the goal setting plan is concerned about of your the boys and girls. As I told you, you just need to understand the level of requirement of your athlete. Let it be a boy or girl, doesn't matter. You as a coach or as a sports psychologist or a physical education teacher, you need to focus on the need of your athlete. What is the present status? First thing you need to find out is three things. You find out the present status, you find out the requirement of the game, and third thing is you find out how much you want to achieve. On the basis of these three things, you can just fix up the goal. Let it be a boy or girl, doesn't matter. No problem.
Okay, then sir, the next question is sometimes hota kya hai ki bacche they are very motivated to participate in sports, but they are not getting that support from parents. So how we can push them or we can encourage them? Because as a teacher we find, as a coach we find ki bachcha kuch kar sakta hai. Sir, please.
Okay. In the present scenario, what happens? The very first thing a parent, this is a fact I'm going to tell you. The very first thing which a parent wants, or the professional security of his child. So only one thing, when you ask the parents, to allow their children to participate in games and sports, they will ask you, sir, what is the future prospect of all these things? So you can just convince, if you are able to convince that these are the future prospects, if you do this, we don't say that, you cannot say that by playing physical education and sports, the future is spoiled. No, there are many opportunities, many chances. We have around 1,500 coaches from different corner of our country sitting here with us. So if you can able to convince the merits and the benefits that they are going to get, yes, you have just hit the bullseye, and they will definitely come for participation.
Yeah, thank you so much, sir. Now the next question is sir, please suggest some more methods to control aggression.
Yeah, actually there are three different methods. One method is you have to control. There are many methods. They can be categorized in three. One thing is to controlling the aggression on the playground. The controlling the aggression of coaches, players and officials. Second thing is controlling the aggression of your spectators. And the third thing is controlling the aggression of general control of the aggression. So there are the methods which I have just discussed can be used by controlling to control the aggression. And another thing, it's a very effective method we just not recently this FIFA has introduced, by awarding a fair play, keeping a fair play award. So there are many small methods which can be used to control that.
Yeah, thank you, sir. Sir, the next question is sometimes what happened that PET or the coaches, they are loaded with many work, especially administrative work. So, and they are very passionate and motivated to involve themselves in developing the sports or especially players. So how they can motivate themselves?
Can you please repeat the question? I could not hear.
As a PET or a community coach, how we can motivate ourselves as we are having a lot of other works to do?
Motivate ourselves.
Yeah. वो अपने आप को कैसे motivate रख सकते हैं? One question is
okay. See, how you can keep you motivated is first thing. Sorry, Dr. Gangwar, it's not PET. Don't say PET. It is physical education teacher. So let it be physical education teacher. Don't take it otherwise.
No.
And the second thing is we can be very highly motivated by just keeping our objectives. See, one thing is when we are doing something, we are whatever we wanted to do in a school setting or in a college setting. If we are able to receive, if you are able to do the objectives, if you are able to achieve the objectives, then what happens, we will be slowly motivated to do the things. And the motivation is a factor, you know, which should not be based on any kind of your extrinsic motivation. It has to be intrinsic, because I have seen many true physical educationists, even they have spent their complete salary. I know you are one among them. They have you know, spent lot of money from their pocket just for betterment of our profession, for the betterment of our physical education and sports. So this motivation has to be intrinsic, so far as your professional motivation is concerned. And of course, job satisfaction is also another factor, and there can be many factors we have to look at.
Yeah, thank you. Now, sir, the next question is that is related to sir. Just tell me what about the mental conditioning training program?
People are calling it mental conditioning training program. Some people call it as mental toughness training program. Some people are calling it mindfulness training program. So this is actually one of the methods of your psychological skill training, wherein you have to develop, you have to expose your athlete into it, rather than, you know, see, there are actually two ways of controlling the distraction to the sports performance. One thing is, you teach your athlete so that he remains away from this, which is not practically always possible, right? Second thing is, you expose your athlete to the similar kind of situation which he or she is going to face in the real life or in the real competition, right? For an example, if you are going to play a match wherein we are expecting 50,000 spectators, the kind of noise you can just imagine. So what you can do is, you can make your athlete play, and you can make your athlete image, teach him to focus, teach him to do imagery and by playing the sound of these spectators cheering off or making a lot of noise. So what will happen is, when you are doing this, you are already exposing your athlete in a man-made or a lab situation, but of course that also will help him when he goes for actual competition, that he will not feel left out, or he will not feel under a lot of stress.
Okay, thank you, sir, for the wonderful answer. Now, sir, the next question is, is there any recommended age group, age category, to apply the sports questionnaire on the players?
No, it's not like that. This questionnaire, this is a question which is irrelevant to this session, but still, as it has been asked, I would love to answer. The questionnaire is just a tool for getting kind of information which will be effective for your research and analysis purpose. Okay, so if you are, the age category means, whenever different questionnaires are made, when the validation and when the validity and reliability of that questionnaire is fixed, that time itself it is decided on which category that questionnaire can be used. Even there are questionnaires which can be used at the, you know, at the age group of 8 to 10. Even I have seen the questionnaire which can be used at the age of 5. But that questionnaire has to be developed on the basis of the data which has collected on the students or the kids from that age group. So every questionnaire has different age group. So that is why this is a humble suggestion to all the physical education teachers and my professional friends, that whenever you are using a questionnaire in your research, be very much sure about the psychological or the psychometric properties of that particular questionnaire, like validity, reliability, then its authenticity, and then its applicability, on which age category and gender it has to be applied. Yes.
Yeah, thank you, sir. Now the next question is, sir, that is, hota kya hum log jab bachcho ke sath deal karte hain to bolte hain self talk karna chahiye. So that question related to that. So sir, what are the methods for self talk? Can you just tell?
What are the
methods for self talk?
Yeah, for self talk, actually, self talk itself is a method, right? So self talk itself is a method of controlling the distractions and promoting the focus or concentration. Okay, so here what you can do is you can, there can be two kind of your self talk. One is your positive self-talk, another one is negative self-talk. But in the presentation which we have just completed right now, I just told you that the positive kind of self-talk is always helpful. So you must help, as a coach and teacher, you must promote the positive self-talk. And at the same time, the negative self-talks, always when you go on blaming about yourself, when you go on blaming you for every small mistake of yours, then at that time what happens, you become more concerned on the negativity and the negative side of it. And thereby that what happens, it creates a lot of pressure on you. It creates a lot of stress and ultimately you break up. You cannot give your best performance, right?
Okay, so here, sir, I'll take the last question and then we'll wind up. So the question is, how to know students' mental abilities?
This is a small question, but it's a very broad question and it's a detailed answer. Whole class, a whole hour can be taken for answering this question. Though it's a very small question, but it needs elaborate answer. In short, I will tell you. There are different procedures of doing research. So research means don't consider this to be a very tough or systematic methods of doing research. There is a kind of method which is called as action research. That means we do that kind of research, to sort out our immediate problems. Okay. So by doing, there are different methods: introspection, observation. So observation, as for a teacher, this observation is a key. By observation only, you will able to find out if there is any athlete who has talent. Okay, then having talent doesn't solve the purpose. An athlete should be having talent, and at the same time, he should be interested. If he has talent but no interest, then that talent is of no use. So we will have to, it has to be a methodical and continuous procedure by using which, we can find out what is the psychological abilities that an individual is lacking. But in general, I can just tell you can go for performance profiling. You can go for performance profiling or the psychological profiling, we call it. If you are interested, very much interested, you can take my mail ID and you can send an email to me. I will definitely give you, I can definitely give you some suggestions, some guidelines by using which it should be easier for you to find out psychological ability. And I'm grateful that you asked these questions. I'm really grateful indeed.
Yeah, that's a very good question. Yeah. Thank you so much, sir. So here we come to end of the session. Thank you so much, Dr. Ashutosh Acharya, sir. It was really a great session, and as you can see in the chat box, it's a huge positive responses from the participants, and that shows how you made this. And personally, it was very it shows your expertise in the subject and your vast experience. So thank you so much, sir, on behalf of Sports
Audio so
India. Ministry of Youth Affairs and Sports, Khelo India, and the entire team of Sai LNCP, and on behalf of our principal, sir, Dr. G. Kishore, sir, really thankful to you for having you being with us. Thank you so much, sir. And now, one announcement for the participants. We have created this platform for you people to get experience. Yeah, please.
Yeah. Sorry. I mean, I would like to say one thing that I'm really sorry to all. I would really like to say sorry to all the participants that we are not able to take all the questions asked by you. Because we are having around more than 100 questions here in line. So, but one thing is, if you are interested, I can share my mail ID to you. Just mail me your questions, and definitely I'll answer to you. Thank you. Thank you so much.
Participants, see, every day we are having three regular sessions, and then evening we are having a session where you can get the information, knowledge from across the world. We are having speakers from many countries. So that session every day we start at 5 o'clock. So please do join that session, and because what is going on, what in physical education and sports worldwide, so the people that experts they are coming and you know making us understand. So please join us in evening session, and thank you so much all the participants for joining us. And really, this is your interest, your you know enthusiasm. You are with us from day one, and thank you so much for making this event to a successful one. Thank you, everyone.
Thank you so much, Dr. Gangwar. Thank you.